Well, it's good to talk to you.
Yes, you too. So, Kevin Burkhardt, you have been before. Actually, let me start over. So, before Fox, before calling NFL games, before, you know, doing the MLB pregame and postgame show, you were a car salesman, which I just find absolutely fascinating. How do you feel being a car salesman prepared you to be where you're at now?
Yeah, you know, it did. I mean, you know, I think it was just it's a lot of things kind of culminating for me at that time. But it was, you know, I was just knocking at a lot of doors and no one was answering. And I just kind of got fed up with my situation. And, you know, I was just done. I was fried and I was upset and angry and all that stuff. So I just picked that job out of a hat. And, you know, I mean, the Sunday classifieds, I just circled a random thing and it happened to be a car dealership. So I went in and, you know, I told the guy, hey, you know, I've never done this before and I'm really a broadcaster, but I'm going to sell cars. He's like, yeah, okay. Like, whatever, go. And, you know, it turned out to be the best thing I ever did, just because there were a lot of things to it, but A, it re-motivated me. You know, I got there and I kind of got my passion back. I was like, okay, I just needed a break. You know, I needed a break of all the bad luck and no one responding to, you know, my stuff. And because I just knew deep down, at least I thought I knew that I was good enough. So it was a good break and it kind of got my fire burning again that I knew I wasn't done and it wasn't going to give up on this broadcasting dream. And then the other thing, it's just doing that in that world. That's a hardcore world now. I mean, you know, you got to fight for putting food on your table when you're selling anything, certainly selling cars. So I just learned a lot about myself and about how to handle people, talk to people, negotiate, things like that. And, you know, it helped me with everything because I started to ask for things that I wanted. And, you know, it's really, sometimes it's just really hard to ask for things you want and to say no to things you don't want. It's just hard, right? Like I'm a person who likes to please people. So for me, I didn't really have that in my DNA. So it taught me that. And I think I just used that and, you know, went forward in my dealings in the broadcast world. So, I mean, I wouldn't be here without that. I mean, that whole journey was so important to my whole story.
So were there any like tools that you took from being a car salesman and like kind of implemented them into the broadcast booth?
I don't know broadcast booth specifically, but I know specifically people skills, no question about it, in terms of just, you know, not being afraid to ask the question, you know. And, you know, I just was always one, I didn't want to step on people's toes, right? I didn't want to annoy people. And now it's just like, you almost have to not, you know, give a you know what, and just ask the darn question, because what's worse, the worst thing someone could say is no, right? So I called up, you know, WFAN in New York, who's one of their, you know, head honchos. There was a guy that I had known a little bit, and just basically asked him if I could have a job there. And he said, yeah, come audition. And I'm like, well, wait a second, all these years I'm like knocking on people's doors and I just had to ask. So obviously it wasn't that simple, but it just taught me, like, don't be afraid. You know, go out and, because like, if you came in, Jenna, to buy a car from me, I'd go out and talk to you and try and help you genuinely and, you know, have my pitch to sell you the car. If I don't ask you to pay me X for the car, you're not going to pay me, right? And the worst you could do is you walk out the door, okay, so then I talk to the next person. So it was that mindset where it's like, so what? Just go and do what you got to do and, you know, and not be afraid. I know that sounds kind of cheesy, but that's really the truth.
It's not cheesy because it kind of, you know, you're kind of leading into what I was going to ask. And someone had said to you, ironically, while you were selling cars, if you don't go and ask these people for what you want and ask them for the price you need them to pay, you're never going to get it. So how did life change for you when you finally were like, this is what I want?
It just reinforced my original conviction that I wanted this. You know, I guess I was just to the point where, I don't know how, I mean, I was, how old was I? I don't know, I guess late 20s at that point, maybe 30. And I just had been, you know, I hadn't been able to kind of get to the next step. And I just thought I was good enough to do it. And then, you know, you get to the point where, okay, should I give up? But I didn't want to give up. I didn't want to have that regret. So, you know, later in my life where it's like, why did I give that up? Why did I not try? So I was just determined while doing that, that I'm going to go and give it all I have and go for this hard for whatever. I didn't really have a set time in my head, but just do it. And then if it really didn't work out the second time, then okay. You know, I just kind of, I feel good about it. I get everything I had. Maybe I wasn't good enough and like on to whatever career choice be. Luckily I never had to get on to Career Choice Speak, because, you know, by doing that, it kind of refreshed me and it kind of got me going that I knew and felt I was good enough for Career Choice A. So it was just, it was hugely important.
Yeah. And I think it kind of goes into like having that confidence in yourself. And I have this new analogy in life from being a bartender. And my analogy is, actually, do I have one? Let's see. I think I do. Hold on. I have a, I'll bring it out. Wait.
Oh, I'm excited. Yeah. I need like a drum roll or something for this.
There it is. I was going to say, I didn't drink it this weekend, but I am a $1,000 bottle of wine. Okay. And the analogy is basically, it's not a matter of if someone's going to buy the wine. It's just who's going to buy the wine.
Yeah.
Sometimes it takes time, like you said, and sometimes it might be faster, but as long as you keep trucking away at it, someone's going to buy it. So you were able to sell Kevin Burkhardt in 2004. Can you sell me Kevin Burkhardt today?
Wow. I mean, what am I selling you? Am I selling you a Chevy Tahoe? What am I selling you, Jenna?
You're selling me you.
Wow. That I've never been asked to do that in my life.
2020, Kevin Burkhardt, sell.
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing is with me, what you get is what you see, right? I mean, I think I'm genuine, and I think on my own personality, right? So it's a subjective business if you're talking about someone who's going to hire you. So kind of like that bottle of wine, you know, even though whatever the price is, someone may think it's not that great. Then the next person thinks it's fantastic. So I can't control what you think of me, but I know I'm confident in my ability as, you know, one of the best, however you want to classify, broadcasters, play-by-play guys, studio hosts in the business. Like I know I stack up. So it's a matter of seeing what I do on air, which I'm confident in, knowing that I can do and handle anything you throw my way. I can't make you like my style, but I can tell you what you see is real. And that's the real thing. That's who I am, you know, off the camera. I just maybe dress a little nicer than you see right now. That's all.
You know, I think sometimes we can all put on our, you know, our best dapper outfit and move forward, and we can sell it a little bit better, kind of like the presentation of a bottle of wine, so to speak.
There you go. There you go. It's all in the label, right?
It's all in the label. Yes. So you have achieved and covered so much already. What's the next great thing you want to accomplish that has nothing to do with what you do, but has everything to do with who you are?
You know, I think that people always want to say like, for example, do you want to do a Super Bowl or do you want to do this and that? Like, I just want to do big events. I like being around big events. I've been fortunate to be around a lot of big events, and I love everything about it. I love the atmosphere, the circumstance, the stakes. And so I think that's really my goal. My goal is to keep working hard, you know, keep producing and putting out a good product. And look, a lot of my job is making who I'm next to better. If I'm calling a football game, I need to make my analysts not only feel comfortable, but I need to make them shine. If I'm doing the studio and hosting a studio show for our Major League Baseball, you know, World Series coverage, whatever, I need to make, you know, A-Rod and Big Poppy and Baker, I need to make them shine. They're the stars of the show. So essentially I'm the quarterback in some ways, right? I take a lot of pride in that. And I just love being around the big events because there's nothing like it. There's nothing like the feel, the pressure, all of it. There's nothing that gets my adrenaline going more than that. I mean, Sunday at a big NFL game, a big divisional rival late in the year, or playoff game, or, you know, the World Series game 7. I've been fortunate to be at these things. And I don't think it has to be a specific thing. Who knows what the future is going to hold, but I just think that adrenaline can't match it.
So you'll be chasing that adrenaline high, we'll say.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's all about that, but it's definitely a part of it. Like, I like being the person in front of that. You know, I think you have to embrace that, right? If you're scared or if you don't, you know, feel comfortable with that, how can you be there for that moment, right? Like, I love that. I get excited for that. You know, when we're, you know, on site for the World Series and everyone is going crazy and the crowd's yelling around us, I bring it on. I love it. It fires me up. So, I don't think it's every part of it, but I think adrenaline is definitely a part of it. Now, I will say there are plenty of times where you have to manufacture your own adrenaline, and that's the challenges of this job, right? I mean, I think, Jenna, that you could put anybody at the World Series or whatever it is, Super Bowl, you know, Daytona 500, you can name any big sporting event. And that's pretty hard to not be excited about. But it's the August baseball game when the team is 30 games out of first place that has not a lot of fans. Those are the days that you earn your money, that you have to make your own adrenaline. So I will say that.